Recursion or recursive function is a feature in any programming languages, which is a special kind of function which calls itself. Means, when we learnt about function, there were two parts, a calling function and a called function. The calling function was taking help of the called function to perform certain tasks. Here, the calling function will call itself for a particular purpose. Definitely there is a purpose, that's why it will be calling itself. So recursion is a program or a type of function which calls itself for execution, and that's why it is called as a recursive call to itself. That's why it is called as a recursion or recursive function. So recursion is a process of repeating items in a similar self-similar way. There is a general English meaning, and in programming languages, if a program allows you to call a function inside the same function, inside itself, then it is called as a recursive call. The way it is written in this syntax, here you can see there is a main function. The main function is calling recursion, function recursion, which is mentioned here. But you can find as soon as it starts the execution, it is calling itself. Okay, so function is calling itself. How exactly it will be done or what is the logic behind that, that we'll see from an example first. So all of you know what do you mean by a factorial. So factorial means if I'm trying to find out a factorial of 4, 4 factorial means it will be 4 into 3 into 2 into 1. So this will be your calculation of factorial. So if it is 5, then 5 into 3 into 5 into 4 into 3 into 2 into 1, and similarly. So if it is n, then we go on multiplying the n minus 1 till you get the last number as 1. So 4 factorial, 3 factorial. What is the factorial of 1? Factorial of 1 will be 1, because that is the last digit which we are dealing with. So how we can now see this as a recursive operation, that that we'll see. Let us say that we are talking about 4 factorial. Factorial of, okay, we'll go for a factorial of 5. So 5 factorial, it will be denoted this way. 5 factorial means it will be 5 into multiplication of all the smaller digits to that. All the till 1. So this will be your factorial of 1. But when I just bifurcate this, what I can observe is it is actually 5 into these four steps are nothing but 4 factorial. Am I right? So this is nothing but 4 factorial. Now, still, how I can look this as 5 into 4 into factorial of 3. Is this particular block creates factorial of 3? Yeah. So what I can conclude from this, so this is factorial of 4. This is factorial of 5. Again, I'll just write one more step. 5 into 4 into 3 into factorial of 2. So this comprises of 3 factorial. This comprises of 3 factorial. This is 4 factorial. This is 5 factorial. Means what I can say is n factorial is equal to n into factorial of n minus 1. So this can be generalized from these calculations. So 4 factorial is 4 into 3, 3 factorial. 3 factorial is 3 into 2 factorial. 5 factorial is 5 into 4 factorial. So thus I can conclude n factorial is n into n minus 1 factorial. Okay, how long it is going to happen? So it will going to happen till we get factorial of 1. Okay, because factorial of 1 is 1. There are no further multiplications happening. So we are going to get this kind of execution till, means ultimately what will be 5 factorial is actually 5 into 4 into 3 into 2 into lastly 1 factorial. Okay. This way, 2 factorial means 2 into 1 factorial, and 1 factorial is 1. So the terminating condition of getting factorial is 1. So once you reach n minus 1 is equal to 1, we are going to reduce that term 1 and can be multiplied in a reverse way. So this way the prime factorial can be found. This particular diagram is showing you the same thing here. Here when I am trying to find out 6 factorial, ultimately I am finding out 6 into 5 factorial. Then 5 into 4 factorial for this purpose. So 5 factorial is now reduced, only this much reduced to this term. This is reduced to the next term. This is reduced to the next term. That's what just now we have seen. This is reduced to the next term. This is reduced to the next term. So 2 factorial is actually 2 into 1 factorial. And now what is 1 factorial? 1 factorial is 1. Now it cannot be further reduced. Now it cannot be further reduced. So what I got is 1. For 1 factorial, it is 1. Now what we are doing, we are returning this value to the just immediate next function. Hierarchy, there is a hierarchy which has been formed, now you can see. So it will return, because see what's happening here is this module is calling 1 factorial. So its solution will be returned to this. Okay, now it becomes 2 into 1, the output becomes 2. Okay, now this value is will be returned to this function. So it becomes, what is factorial of 2? It is 2 into 1, that is 2. So 2 is returned to it. So this 2 factorial is now replaced with 2. So it is 3 into 2, it is 6. Okay. Now this new value is returned to the previous function. Previous function. Previous function means 4 into 6. It becomes 4 into 6, comes out to be 24. Okay. 24 is returned to the higher value, it becomes 120. Higher level. This 120 is actually 5 factorial value of 5 factorial. 5 factorial will be reversed. So 6 into 120, this is coming out to be 7. This will be 720. So ultimately 6 factorial will be 720. Are you getting me? So what happened in this case is in every level, we actually tried to find factorial of n minus 1. So 6 into 5 factorial. So n into n minus 1. Now for n minus 1, I am again executing the factorial function. Then for 4 factorial, I am again executing the factorial function. So similarly, this way the recursion will happen. What will happen? What's happening here is the task is getting repeated by itself, but of course with different values. Let us see a small program for recursion. What will happen in this case? Let us say that this I have just taken as long integer factorial unsigned integer I. It is going to take an unsigned integer value I. So we will try to input positive values for it. And then the name of the function is factorial. And unsigned long int means if I am taking integer as 4, it will be long int will be 8 bytes, and long int will be 8 into 16 bytes. So we are just increasing the size of it. This is just to illustrate this can be used. Now coming back to the program, what I am trying to do is int main, we have declared I is equal to 12. And now I am trying to find out factorial of i. So at this case, at this point, factorial number factorial is called. The function factorial is called. What will happen now? Now, the function factorial will be called first time with, I'll just draw something, with value input as 12, the factorial is called. Okay, so with input 12, we went here, we called this function, and we are just checking. So now value of I is copied into this I. This I belongs to main. This I belongs to factorial. So value of I is copied here. Now I is 12 for this case. I is 12. If I is less than equal to 1, no, this condition is not true. This condition is not true. So it is calling I into factorial of I minus 1. Okay. So either return 1 if it is less or equal to 1. Otherwise, you return I into factorial of I minus 1. This is a new function call. This is a new function call. So what will happen now? This is not going to return anything right now. It will put this function on hold because a function is called inside a function. When function is called, immediately the control will pass to the new function which is called. And the function which is calling it will be put on hold for some time. Okay. Now factorial I minus 1. What is I? I is 12. So now this function with I equal to 12 is called over the function. Sorry, I is equal to 11 is called over the previous function. Okay. What happened here now? See, if addition is false, so else part is executed. And this else part is calling a function factorial. The function is itself. The function is calling itself. So there is a recursive call here. So factorial I minus 1 is nothing but factorial 11. So the function which was having I equal to 12 is put on hold. And we came back with the new function called with I equal to 11. So now this I become 11. Again, enter into the function, I is not equal to 1. I am going to come to this part. Again a new call is done. So this is a third call made to function factorial without finishing the previous function. Okay, remember, without finishing the previous functions, all are put on hold. So we'll execute a new function, new factorial function with input is equal to. Again, the similar way, input equals 9, 8, 7, 6. And now after 2, there will be value 1. Okay, at this moment, what will happen? Factorial of 1. Okay, so factorial of 1 will be called. I will become 1. I is equal to 1. It will return 1. So the if part will be executed, not the else part. If part will be executed and it is going to return 1. To whom it is going to return 1? Will it return main here? One here? No. It is going to return 1 to its calling function. Who called it? Factorial 2 called it. And when I is equal to 3, this 3 minus 1, that is 2. Factorial 2 called it. So one value will be returned to this function. Okay? One value will be returned to this function. Now what will happen? Now what will happen? I into, so this will be 2 into 1. This will be 2 into 1. It is going to generate a value 2. This value will be returned to the So here 1 will be returned, here 2 will be returned, here 2 will be returned. Okay, then to the next function, when factorial 3 was, it will be 3 into 2 into 1. So this will be returned, returning 6 to factorial 4. This will be returning 24. So this will be returning 120, sorry. This will be returning 24. This will be returning 120. This will be returning 720. And so on now. Okay. So all these functions are going to return a value to its calling function, not to the main function. And last function, where we have called factorial with the input 12, that is only going to, for it, the calling function is main. For all rest of them, the calling function is factorial itself. There is a calling function for factorial itself. This is the last, only for the last function call, that is equal to 12, the calling function is main. So at this moment, it is going to return a value of factorial 12. I don't know what the value of factorial 12, so just multiply 12 into 11 into 10 into and so on till 1. So this way, the functions of recursive calls are handled. Okay, are you getting me? So here again, I am repeating that there was only one factorial was called by main. Only one. When I was equal to 12. For rest, the function is calling repeatedly itself. Factorial calling repeatedly itself till it gets the answer of factorial of 5. Okay? And then it will return the value of factorial of 12, and that will be written to main. Rest, whatever passing the elements or returning the elements is going on between the various versions of factorial. What are various versions of factorial? Factorial 11, factorial 10, factorial 9, and so on. Till factorial 1. These are versions of factorial only. These are the calls made to factorial only. Okay? So, this is the way it is done. And whatever I have done, drawn here is called as a stack. It's called as a stack. What happens in stack? In stack, you can input the elements from one end and you can take them out only from that end. Okay? Only from that end. So the element which is entered first is going to come out later. Every time the new element will be pushed on that, will be put on that. Okay? So if I want to remove this element, first I need to remove this element. So that's what's happening here. So the hierarchy is properly maintained. I will first finish out the execution of this function, then call of execution of function, then execution of this, and so on. So automatically, in the reverse order, we are going to finish with the execution, and finally, we are going to get factorial of I as 12. So is it okay, or do I need to repeat the thing? No need to repeat. Is it okay? At least you prompt in the chat box if it's comfortable or even not. So every what happens is I get the ask the question or ask whether it is clear or not. There are very typical names who will always answer. Will always answer. Yes, sir. We have got it. Okay, there are very few names. I don't know what others are doing, others are really understanding it or not, or interested or not. I always face this doubt, but still, now it's your own to take the things out. As you are not physically there every time, I'm not able to evaluate you or see your faces whether you have understood or not. When we are in a physical class, generally we look at your face and it is understood to us that whether the topic is clear or not. But it is difficult in this kind of virtual environment to really judge. So it is it's you who should judge that whether you have understood the topic or not. Okay, and it's your job only. If you have not understood, you should get back to me or get back to one of your friends who has understood the topic to get it clear. Fine. I expect that this was clear. And with this, we'll see all the discussions, whatever we have done. We have, it may be functions, loops, pointers, it's arithmetic, basic C constructs, whatever are there. All are just introductory discussions towards that. As and when you practice more and more, you are going to explore many things. So in the data structures, all things we are going to see, or we are going to use them actually. So that time you will be exploring more and more things. So the topic, end of topic, is doesn't mean that it is the end of that particular topic. It is not a theory topic that yes, it's learned and it's over. This is just the introduction, and we are coming to know how these things should be used. Okay, and once you know that they are, how they are to be used, you are forced to use it frequently. Now, coming to one interesting topic in C, which is storage classes in C. What are storage classes in C? We declare variable very often. In nearly every program, we declare various variables. So every variable has a particular storage class. Okay. The storage class in C are used to determine the lifetime, visibility, memory location, and initial value of a variable. When I'm just simply saying int A, there is a location of in the memory allocated will be reserved for that integer A. So if it is an integer, these many bytes need to be reserved for that. So that we know. But if I have not initialized that, what default value it is going to take? If I am not, how long it is going to be visible, how long it is going to reside in the memory, that is decided with the help of storage class. That we have got seen till now. So there are four types of classes. That's what we are going to see now. Because sometimes you may need to operate on the variables little differently than we do in the normal practice. So there are four classes. The automatic class, which is called as an auto class also, external class, static class, and register class. So there are four types of classes, four types of storage classes: automatic class, external class, static class, and register class. Okay, auto is the thing which we are right now generally using. We are not mentioning any of the things, and so it will be placed in the RAM. See, whenever I say that it is placed in the memory, I am always talking about the primary memory. There is no scope of using secondary memory during execution. Whatever is being executed may reside in secondary memory, but it will be brought to the primary memory and then only it can be executed. So, when I declare an auto variable, so these are the storage places where that's going to be allocated. That's what is shown to us. At what place it will be allocated, what will be the default value it is going to take if it is not initialized with any value, then what value it is going to take. So it is the garbage means any random value it is going to take of no significance. Okay, but some variables are initialized to zero by default, even if we are not doing it. In the coming discussion, you will be coming to know that. Scope of a variable means, we have seen a global variable scope and a local variable scope, where that variable which is declared will be local for that particular function or will be global for the entire program. And the lifetime, how long that particular function sorry, not function, that variable is going to reside or stay or live. So this is the lifetime of that variable. Like I said, once the function is the formal parameters, we had said about formal parameter, as soon as you enter in the function, it will be alive. Once you exit the function, it will be there, or it will be no more in existence. So that is decided. So these four things are decided with the help of storage classes. The storage location, what will be the default value or initial value, will be the scope of it, and what will be the lifetime. Scope means visibility and lifetime of it. So these are the four things which we are going to see. These elaboration I'll do in the discussion one by one. Automatic storage class. Automatic storage class is the normal practice whatever we are doing. Okay, we are declaring simply int A. It is by default auto. Okay, if you want to exclusively make it automatic, you can make use of the keyword auto. But otherwise, it is by default, it is automatic. Okay, so automatic storage class is denoted by the keyword auto, where automatic variables are allocated memory automatically at the runtime. Whenever you start executing the program, they'll be getting the memory, and all the variables which are related to that, all the values which are related to that particular variable will be stored into that. So, but the visibility of this automatic variables will be very limited to the block in which they are defined. Very limited to the block in which they are defined. The function, if you're a function block, sometimes it may be a case structure, it may be any kind of structure which you are defining, but it will be limited to only that block. It cannot be accessed out of it. The scope of automatic variable is limited to the block in which they are defined, and visibility is also very local or limited to that block in which they are defined. And the automatic variables are initialized to a garbage value at by default. It will not be 0, 1 or anything, any specific value. It will be a garbage random value, which is of no significance. Of course, the memory to it is allocated in the RAM or in the primary memory, and which is freed upon exiting from that block. So, which will be free. The lifetime will not be permanent in this case, because we said that the visibility and scope will be limited to the block in which it is defined. And so, as soon as you exit that block, that memory will be freed from that. So, every local variable is automatic in C by default, unless and until we are making it very clear. Okay. So, this is a general variable which we are using, but exclusively you can make it automatic by specifying a keyword auto. This is a simple program which is actually illustrating auto. So, if I am just declaring three variables in A, character B, and float C, and trying to print them without assigning any value, it is going to print all the garbage values for it. Okay. So, you can see there is no difference in normal declaration and auto declaration. So, that's what I am saying. Any normal declaration C is by default a auto declaration. And by default, they are going to take a garbage value. So, this printf statement is going to some garbage value, which will be assigned to A, B, and C. But now see here. What difference you can observe? See, C language is so deep that every time you go through the program, and sometimes you find that, you may find that this is not going to work, but it works. So here you can see that integer main is declared and a variable A is equal to 10 is declared. So A and I both are auto variables, but the default value is definitely garbage, but A is now initialized to 10. So A will be 10 and I will be garbage value, unless and until it is initialized to some value. Okay. So now in this case, what will happen if I am printing plus plus A? If I am printing plus plus A, so A will be incremented first and is going to print 11. So A value is changed to 11 in this. Now a new block is created because of these braces. Okay, because of these braces, a new block is created where I am redeclaring integer a to 20, reinitializing a to 20. Okay, but it is a declaration. It's not only assignment. It is a declaration. So a is equal to 20. And now I'm just running a for loop three times and printing a. Okay, so every time the b will be printed three times since it is a local value of a. So here you can see, because of this for loop, we are printing a. But what happened in this case, a is not going to take the value 11 or is not going to take any value from external block, outer block. It is going to take the value of a from the inner block. So this is the inner block. From these braces to these braces, the inner block is there, and for which integer a is equal to 20 is declared. So for this block, for all matters, it is going to print 20. Okay, it is going to print 20. In this case, if you are making it print plus plus a, you are going to get it 21 20 23, because every time it is going to take value of a within that block. Okay, because it is local for that block. And now as soon as I come out of this block, I am again trying to print the value of a, it is going to print 11. It is going to print 11. So a is equal to 20 scope has ended at this particular point. Okay, the block is over, so its scope is ended, and now it will so this a value is the part of this block. This statement is the block of outer block, and hence it will print 11. This program may be sounding very strange for you, because how we can declare a variable over here. But it is a valid C construct. It is supported because A is already declared and we are just redeclaring it. So it is not going to produce any error. It is going to work, and this will be the output. So yes, that's what I said. Every time you practice, you are going to explore new thing about C. So this is a valid statement. Is about the automatic storage class. So even though we are finding it general, even though we are finding that we are frequently using it, yes, these are the changes which you need to adopt. This is most important storage class among all, and most frequently used storage class, that is static storage class. When we are declaring some value, it may be a global or local value, and we don't want that value to be changed by different functions, different times. So at that time, we can make it static. So the variable defined static specifier can hold their value between the multiple function calls. So whatever value it takes, it will retain. Till the execution of, say, let us say that we have declared a variable static a as 10, and some function has made it 12. It is going to retain that 12 is going to retain for next purposes. It's not like the changes made into that block will remain in that block. It will be a global kind of change. So static local variables are visible only to the function or block in which they are defined. They are visible. They are visible. So I'm not talking about the changes. The visibility will be in the that block. A same static variable can be declared many times, but can be assigned at only one time. Okay, only once we can assign. Initial value, it is going to take it as zero, not a garbage value, because it is going to retain that value. So you cannot take any garbage value. So it is automatically initialized to zero. And the visibility of static global variable is limited to the file in which it has been declared. So it will be available in all the functions. And we are going to use the keyword static to declare it. With example, the things will be more clear. Let's see example. We'll start the execution from main, and there is a function void sum which is declared. So void main, you have declared i is varying from 0 to 3, and you are calling function sum. You are calling function sum. So what changes we can expect here? So include stdio.h void sum. A variable a and variable b are declared, which are initialized to 10 and 24, but they are not normal variables. Both the variables are static. Both the variables are static. They'll be local to sum only. They'll be local to sum. But again, I am repeating, they are going to retain the changes made in them. They are going to retain the changes made in them. In case, what will happen here is print A and B. So it is going to print 10 and 24, right? 10 and 24. This is very simple. And A is incremented and B is incremented. So the values are changing to 11 and 25. The values are changing to 11 and 25. The execution is over. Execution is over. Function is not returning anything. For I equal to 0, it has printed 10, 24. Values of A are changed to 11 and 25. And now coming back to I is equal to 1, sum is again called. So there will be a second call to sum. There will be a second call to sum. And again, it will come to that this declaration. But now, it is not going to redeclare it, but it is going to use the same variable. So if I'm printing now, if I'm printing A and B, it is going to print what were the values changed? 11 and 25. Because in the previous call of sum, the static variables A and B were incremented by 1 and have accepted the value 11 and 25. So same value will be carried in the second call. In the third call also, same thing is, so again, A will be incremented, B will be incremented, will take value 12 and 26. And again, sum will be called, the static is going to take the new values which were updated, and this is going to print 20, 12 and 26. Understanding it? Are you understanding it? What's happening here? So this way, the function calls are going to work on the static variables. Okay, one thing we'll see here. What will happen if I'm not having this aesthetic? Let us say that I'm not having V as a static variable. So there is, it's a normal variable. So what will be happening? Sum will be called with I is equal to 0. Sum will be called, A will be 10, B is 24. So 10 and 24 will be printed. 10 and 24 will be printed. A is incremented to 11. B is incremented to 25. It is not returning anything. Will come back for I equal to 1. A second call to sum will be given. A is observed to be static. So it is going to accept the changes which were made in the previous call. Whereas B is not static. So it is going to get reinitialized. So it will be printing 11, 24. 11, because A is static, so it has accepted the changes which were made in the previous call. B is not static, so it is going to get redeclared and reinitialized to 24. In the third call, again, it is going to retain the changes, and this is going to be 24. So have you got the difference between a normal variable and a static variable? So static variable is going to keep the changes. Of course, it is not accessible outside a main. Outside the sum, it will be accessible only within sum, but it will retain the values till the end of program. Whatever changes you have made, it is going to retain it. See here what it is going to print. So all variables are static and all are made as global. Made as global. We are not making any changes. We are just printing out this initial value of C, I, and F will be printed. All are initialized to zero. All are initialized to zero, and it will just be created. This will not be printing anything. Okay. So this is the way we can make use of static. So either static can be a global variable or static can be a local variable. Okay. So the two simple other things are remaining. I'll make it a little faster. Register. Have you heard the word register? Register are special kind of memory blocks which are reserved, which are there with the CPU, and they'll be of 8 bits, 16 bits, or 32 bits. So you are saying that your machine is 16 bit or 32 bit. It is basically the size of register you are talking about. So register are not memory pieces. It's not the piece of memory, primary memory, but are special type of memory blocks which are directly connected to the CPU. And for very fast transfers, for very temporary variables, these registers will be used. Okay, any variable you declare will be declared in the memory, but in this case, the register in the register storage class, the memory will be the variable will be stored in the register. Register is a special block which is very near to the CPU. There may be 8 registers, there may be 16 registers, there may be 32 registers in a CPU. That depends on the CPU and its power. So the variable defined register is allocated the memory into the CPU register. Depending upon the size of memory remaining in the CPU. Okay, CPU mein kitna jagah hai? I'm not talking about the primary memory here. So this storage class will be used only if you are very particular about using that variable, and that that need to be accessed very fast. At that time only you are going to use this. Very rarely we use the high level programmer or memory level programmer or OS level programmer will use this kind of thing. So we cannot dereference the register value, as we cannot use the ampersand operator for the register variable. As I said, it is not the part of memory, primary memory. We cannot use the address of it. Okay, these variables will not have any address. They will have a specific register number. The access time of register variable is faster than the automatic variable because they will be comparatively smaller than the memory. And very nearer to the CPU. CPU can directly access them. The default value of register variable is set to zero because it has a limited size. The register keyword, register, I'm not saying it as register, register. The register keyword is used for the variable which should be stored in the CPU register. However, the compiler's choice whether or not the variable can be stored in the register. Okay, so if the registers are already busy in handling some important other inbuilt variables, it may not permit you to do that. But if registers are free, you can do it. So we can store pointers in the register so that the addresses can be very easily accessed. And the static variables cannot be stored into registers since we cannot use more than one storage specifier for the same variable. So it cannot be static register. Either it can be register or it can be static. Okay. So generally we won't be using it, but just understand registers are the special type of memory pieces which are directly connected to CPU or which are the part of CPU. The last topic in today's discussion, external storage class. This is quite interesting, but is you need to handle it very carefully. The external storage class is used to tell the compiler that the variable defined as external is declared with an external linkage elsewhere in the program. So you are declaring it as external so that you can redeclare somewhere in the program later on. Right now you don't know where to be used or how it need to be initialized, so you can declare it somewhere later. The example will make the thing clear. Like here what we are doing, if I am writing int main, an external variable int a is declared, the compiler will search here for a variable a defined and initialized somewhere in the program or not. Okay, so it is just informing the compiler that we have some external variable in the piece of program. It may be declared somewhere. It may be declared somewhere. So just find out what is the value it's holding and use it. So int a is declared as external and I am trying to print a. So at this moment it is going to search the value in the program. It is finding a is declared as 20 here. So this is going to print out 20. Okay, this is going to print 20. What happened here? So this is a valid code. Again, you can see that, you can say that sir, it is outside main. How it can be executed? Yes, it can be executed because A is already declared as external variable. So it can be declared outside the code with outside any block. This is also a valid C program. You can take this piece of code and try to execute on any of the compilers. It will be validly executed. So that's what I'm trying to say here. The variable declared as external are not allocated in any memory. It is only declaration and intended to specify that the variable is declared elsewhere in the program. So wherever it is declared in the program, that time it will be allocated with the memory. When it is associated with the external keyword, at that time there will be no allocation. The default initial value of external integer type is zero, otherwise null. And we can initialize external variable globally, and we cannot initialize the external variable within any block or a main. So it can be only global or it can be declared only main. The external variable can be declared many times but can be initialized only once. For a variable is declared as external, then the compiler searches for that variable to be initialized somewhere in the program, which may be external, which may be static also. Okay, if it is not, then the compiler will show an error. If it is not declared, then it will show an error. So you have to declare it somewhere in the program. This program says here we have int A is not initialized, and here is declared globally, and here I am declaring external int A is equal to zero. So this is not possible. You cannot declare initialize the variable at the same time, and you can make it external. So this will show a compiler error since we cannot use external and initializer at the same time. So we cannot, we can either initialize it or you can make it external. External keyword is just giving you the information that yes, this kind of variable is existing somewhere in the program. And it will be declared, defined and initialized there only. So this is going to generate a compile time error because we are initializing and making it external at the same time. Okay. So external and register variables, we are generally not using. Every time you are using a auto variable, and you need to practice out using static variables. So static among these four comes out to be a important or new element which is to be learned and practiced. Rest need to be known and will be enough for that. So this was the discussion for today's class about function and static storage classes. I am repeating that in the next 3 days, I expect you to learn about dynamic memory allocation. I think I have already said it to the section B and section A students. And for both, of course, learn dynamic memory allocation. From Monday, we are going to use dynamic memory allocation for further programming. Okay, so learn dynamic memory allocation. Okay, so that is that has to be done by you. That has to be that has to be prepared by you. If you have some doubts, you can definitely ask me, but you will have to study it by yourself. Dynamic memory allocation. Fine. This was all from my side. Little late, so I expect you to leave the class and join the next link which might have been posted. Thank you very much for this. You may leave the class.